breaking agenda on a day that India is coming to grips with a cyber attack which apparently has impacted 200,000 computers across 150 countries. Now there are isolated reports coming from different parts of the country that India has been impacted too by this virus, which apparently is so potent that if anybody in an office opens that one link or attachment, it can spread and actually limit all other computers in that office. Warnings about this are being sent out by the IT department of the government. In fact, they're having emergency meetings this evening as well. And we'll be speaking to experts and taking questions over here on Agenda. But first of all, the three places which are impacted by this ransomware deadly virus, which is actually brought to a halt the NHS system in the UK. They had to send patients back from hospitals because they couldn't access their data. That's the worst that we've heard happening right now across the world with the cyber data. And in fact, warnings are being sent out to Indian ATMs as well about their operation. But first, one of the places that's been impacted is Kerala and Panchayat offices. And joining us first is the Inspector General, Manoj Abraham, who looks after cybersecurity. Thank you, Mr. Abraham, for speaking to NDTV. Can you tell us how is it that the Panchayat computers in Kerala have got impacted? I know it's a small number. I know it's a few computers. But what kind of impact are you seeing, sir?
Basically, this is a vulnerability in the Windows operating system as such. So basically, the alerts were there. We had also issued a lot of alerts. But basically, if you don't update the patch as well, the Microsoft company has been patches. They put a patch for this in March 2017 also. But many of the Windows users, some are pirated versions, they did not update their operating system. That's how this malware could actually get into their systems and affect the Panchayat offices as such. And of course, the latest antivirus software...
Is it true that you also use pirated software?
No, it's basically the patch, basically the patches which they issued by Microsoft, they were not, the operating system was not updated with the latest patches. So the vulnerability was there. And that is what Microsoft has been issuing advisories that they should put it up to date. Everybody should update their operating systems as such. So if you don't do that, of course, you are open to all these attackers.
Okay, so thank you so much, Mr. Manoj Abraham, telling us about the impact that it's had. And, you know, thinking about the number of computers here in India, this was one thing, one area, only a few computers in Kerala. I just, before we speak to our experts, we have Saket Modi over here. He's an ethical hacker and also joining us a cyber expert from Bangalore, Vandana Verma. Before we just go across to them, another place which has been impacted is West Bengal. Monideepa Banerjee joining us now. Monideepa, tell us what kind, we've heard about Kerala. How has it impacted, how has ransomware impacted the power department in Bengal and which areas?
Well, for the second day running, we are seeing ransomware attacks across Bengal. Today, two districts have been affected. Very widespread in Birbhum district, where the power utility offices run by the state government, three of them have been affected in Birbhum district at Rampurhat, Bolpur and Shuri. And then further up north in Jalpaiguri district, in Dhupguri, the same organization's office has been affected as well. Since yesterday, there is just one difference. Yesterday, the demand was apparently for 300 bitcoins at every place that was attacked. Today, that's gone up to 600 bitcoins, apparently. That's what we are hearing. Yesterday, there were attacks at West Midnapur, East Midnapur, and South Dinajpur as well. Again, the same offices, West Bengal State Electricity Distribution Company Limited. Now, the authorities are telling us there is no serious impact. Services have not been affected at all. Only ordinary people who are going to pay bills at the cash centers, they are facing some trouble. But The situation has alarmed the government, and high-power meetings were held today at the State Secretariat between the administration and the police to try and see what can be done to stop it. An emergency number has also been issued by the police.
Thank you, Muniba Banerjee, for that. So three instances of some kind of hacking and some kind of that impacting in Andhra Pradesh police over the weekend as well. If we can start with you, Saket Modi, should we just thank our stars because that, you know, our, and just for our audience references, Saket Modi also works with the government in securing key apps like the Bheem app, things like that. So he should know how it works. Should we be glad that digitization hasn't happened so extensively? Otherwise, we'd be really badly hit. And also, I want you to explain, Microsoft, while giving out a statement, they've said this shows why the stockpiling of vulnerability government is such a problem, and it is an emerging pattern in 2017. Should we thank the God that we haven't been digitized fully, that we are kind of buffered from this?
You see, the point which you're making is almost as it's something which I feel which shouldn't be taken into consideration at all, saying thankfully we are not digitized. Because let's be very clear on this part, that the advantages of going digital far outweigh the challenges. A $15 trillion economy that the United States is makes 80% of its payments using technology.
Right.
And still, hacks happen. We've seen, starting from the DNC till the JP Morgan Chases of the world being hacked. And still, that doesn't mean that they say, oh my God, I'm getting hacked because we are digitized. Because, again, the advantages far outweigh the disadvantages. But on the other side, yes, we've been fortunate enough because the digital adaption to our systems, to what things are, has not been to that scale where a worm like this would affect us to a very large extent. So it's a luck by chance thing where things didn't affect us in a big way, but that doesn't mean that the systems which we have currently have any upgraded defense mechanism as a result of which we got protected by this worm.
We don't have that.
Nobody has that. When the UK, the Russians, the United States don't have it,
right,
then we don't have it, and that's the way the world is right now.
Okay, Vandana Verma, what about this current attack? Because if you think about it, if you think about the potential that this did have, in a way, UK very badly affected. People can't access their hospitals. Appointments had to be cancelled in the UK. In another place in Germany, a station had to close down because they couldn't get into their system. What would you say about the kind of impact that it's had over here, and also our responses? I think the Home Ministry has already sent out an advisory to ATMs as well. How would you assess this?
So when we talk about sending advisories, giving sessions, even India CERT has given session on ransomwares and how to handle them. Our systems have also been affected, not majorly like England or Stockholm or any other location, but our systems have also been affected by it. Even a lot of ATMs have been infected by it, and as you mentioned, West Bengal power utility systems, they are also infected by it. These are affected on more towards the outdated systems that we have in place, and the less lack of education that we have for cyber security. If we have more of cyber security education for the people across the country, not just for the people who are into media, technology, but across. And the impact is not yet coming up at the very broader level in India. The systems are infected. I can tell you a lot of internet service providers are also affected by it. It's just that the people are not very responsive towards it. And they're asking 300 worth of bitcoins. If you do not pay within 3 days, they will increase the money to $600 bitcoins. And then post 1 week, they will wipe the systems off. So what people think, what people are thinking, or the companies are thinking, that why to give the money, but rather than wipe the systems. That's what, and they don't want to be they don't want to be in the limelight. That's why the impacts are not being shown here, basically in India.
Right. And Jitin Jain, if I can ask you, I know you're there in London. Sitting there in London, do things look really grim?
Well, you know, I would say that yes, UK has been one of the bigger victims of the attack, but what is surprising is that we have a very structured response mechanism in place. And National Cyber Security Center here in the UK, you know, had given a very...
And even, you know, they have been working with for the mitigation with different sectors. And they've been very active within the first 24 hours. And I guess this is what we lack here in India, that, you know, the first, this so-called greeting from third came 48 hours later in the morning. So, you know, while Saket said that UK, US, especially everybody has been vulnerable, you know, no doubt about it. But where I disagree is that these countries have better security response mechanisms in place. They are very active. And in India, why all the figures what we are seeing in the media are all speculative, because there is no qualitative figure to quantify this loss. Because in India, we do not
have a very structured reporting system. Most of the major sectors,
right,
they prefer not to report the incidents to CERT because of the loss of market goodwill and reputation. And that is why what we are seeing in India is a completely under-reported and understated scenario. And it's not a problem of awareness. I think it's a problem of, you know, judgments and mentality we have, that we do not prefer
That's
to invest
really
in cybersecurity.
That's a really important point. Jitin Jain, I wanted to take that to Saket as well. Do you think it's been underreported?
I couldn't
because
hear
people,
what you said, sorry.
Do you think people just didn't report it because they didn't want their stocks to be impacted? They didn't want to spread panic, because this is something that many are saying, that the reason why we're not, that's why we only hear the government departments reporting it and not the private ventures at all.
No, so here's the thing. I think that thing totally makes sense. However, let's not forget that even in the private sector, there's a category of corporates which is called the national critical infrastructure, where your banks, your airports, your aviation companies, a lot of them come into play.
Right.
Banks, for example, is mandated with a rule that you have to report a breach within 6 hours of the incident that happens.
Right.
So why I'm saying this to you is, it's impossible that a bank would get breached and not report to the RBI or the CERT India, which took a webinar today morning, and in fact CERT very clearly stated that, look, it's actually being overhyped than what the impact has been in India specifically. Yes, globally there's been a large impact in terms of number of computers, and it's the first of its kind that we've seen at this scale.
Uh-huh.
I'm not denying that. But India and where it is in terms of the impact, things don't look that bad. So,
well, yeah. Unless it is being reported much less. You're right about the banks, because they would be. Yeah, what question do you have?
So ma'am, my basic question being that though there are many international legislations and treaties being formed on the cyber crime, but now sir, discussing regarding the bitcoins, which is one of the most prominent source of transfer of money from on the international level, India on current state doesn't have any legislation for governing the bitcoins. And also sir, if we see the ground level state, then this information regarding the cyber security is not that clear than it is in the higher level of our nation. So now sir, For example, taking a basic example of downloading any app on a phone, we need to give too many permissions to that app, for example, for making calls, for checking our contacts, and many other permissions.
Yeah, that's a good question. Yeah. Are we making ourselves vulnerable when we do this? What are some of the easy things to follow? Is there a checklist which people should do now?
So first question which can be there, just modifying your own question, there are close to 11 million apps on the App Store. Why doesn't Google itself or Apple itself bar the applications which use more permissions than what it's actually required? The answer to that is 11 million apps, where you have literally tens of thousands of apps coming up on the store on an everyday basis. It's practically not feasible for any company to do that. Now that you get an application, you today are enabled with technologies where both on Android and iOS you can actually specifically remove the permissions, which was not present 2 years back. So 2 years back, when an app asks you for a permission of accessing your pictures, your camera, all of that, you cannot not opt it 2 years back. But today, with all the latest versions of Android and of course the latest version of iOS, you can actually...
So should you be, just for security's sake, you should be saying, no, I don't want to give you access?
Not to all of it. So like an Uber will not be able to operate if it doesn't have an access to your location.
Right.
But on the other side, it doesn't need to see your location all day and all night.
Yeah.
So when you operate an Uber, go to your location settings and switch on the settings so that you can see that then and there,
okay,
rather than, you know, the entire.
Okay, before I take more questions, Vandana Verma, I wanted to ask you, is there something that the government could do which you're not seeing right now? I know you're saying that make people more aware. But how? What would you like in policy level or policy terms to be changing or to be initiated?
See, when you say that how we can make ourselves safe and secure, then I would say we need to make sure that we install the latest security updates or patches, because that's the key to make, that's the first step to keep yourself safe. And another thing would be to when I tell about education, educate the people about that you need to be very careful when you are clicking or downloading apps or executable from an unknown source.
Okay.
Or we should suggest that it should be only downloaded from the trusted sources. Like for in the case of application or Android, it should be.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Jitin Jain, what would you like to see from the policy side changing in order to make ourselves much more secure?
I think, you know, Sunetra, this whole, problem of ransomware today have responded, exposed our policy side. You should appreciate that today RBI is an issue and advisory to all the banks that you should not operate any ATMs which are not running with updated OS or which are not passed. Now, this issue has been lingering for the last 2.5 years. I mean, this advisory could have been issued, or this order could have been issued 2 years back. Why we have this reactive mentality to, you know, issuing such orders post the incident? I think we must learn to, act in a very proactive manner.
I just want to say, to be fair, the IT ministry apparently sent out that reminder. It was just reissued over the weekend. They apparently sent that reminder in March as well, telling everyone that they must update their apps, update their security. But we'll take a short break now, right now on agenda. When we come back, more questions and just some safeguards of couple of simple things that you can do to secure yourself, your work environment, and the computers there. Remember, it's something that we're using so much of right now, using our computers to make payments. So we need them all secured. So stay with us, and we'll talk about that. Welcome back on Agenda. We're talking about ransomware, the cyber attack which is seen. Well, one estimate says 200,000 computers being impacted across 150 countries. India, in a way, we've just seen 3 instances of reported malfunctioning and the virus spreading. These are 3 government departments. And so we're taking questions for our panel right now with the audience. What question did you have?
So many people are using who doesn't have time, and they are using by internet, they are using banking transaction,
right,
this bank to another bank. So my question is this,
is that safe or not?
So all the stuff which is being used right now in terms of banking, what you're talking about, right? In fact, you know what, I just got a WhatsApp message saying that every banking system in India is hit by a strange virus,
yeah,
and better stay away from banking or doing any transactions.
We should do it or not.
That's my point.
So I can assure you of this part.
Yeah.
Being a services provider to almost all of the top 10 banks in India, it is not in any remote way, that bad. Absolutely.
Okay,
just be rest assured with that.
Okay, great. What's the question that you had? Yeah.
Ma'am, my question is that if we get affected, what should we do?
What do you mean? If suddenly your computer says it's going off, what should you do? That's a good question, actually. Vandana Verma, do you want to take that? If, suppose, somebody finds that they open a link or anything like that and it looks like their computer's crashed, what should they do?
So the very first thing should be, it should be taken down from the internet. That should be the first step. Because I'll give you an example. If it's a standalone system or a user system, a single user system, then that has to be scanned first. for possible vulnerabilities or for possible infections. Because when you talk about ransomware, it actually starts encrypting your files. So you need to scan it and, or if possible, try and format it. And when it comes to the corporate level, generally corporates take backups. Then try, first of all, take down the system from the network, scan the drives or the possible shared drives which the computer is connected to, make sure the system is scanned properly, and if possible, try and restore the backup. Example, if the system is infected on Saturday and you...
The crucial advice given there, what do you want to add?
A couple of points which I want to add. First of all, ransomware is about your machine getting encrypted. So, you know, you click on a link and all your data gets encrypted where you don't have an access to your computer anymore.
Right.
I mean, when you switch it on, all you get to see is one screen saying you can't click on anything and you literally cannot. That's the meaning of ransomware.
Right.
Because the message that comes is you need to now pay a ransom, which is $300, to decrypt that data. That's the meaning of ransomware, firstly.
Right.
Secondly, there's no question of doing any scans at that point because everything's already encrypted and you don't have an access to your system.
So then what do you do?
You pay the money. So the point is this, you really cannot go to a point where you can decrypt that file because literally every instance of the ransomware is using different hashes to encrypt that data. So once that happens, think of it like this, I'm using a special language to talk to you. Will it be easy for somebody else to decipher that? No, if we make our own language. That's how encryption works, right? So if this is so... And most of the ransomwares which are used, and this is not a new thing. I mean, as a company, we receive anywhere between 3 to 4 requests on a weekly basis on ransomwares hitting so many computers across the country.
And what do you tell them? To pay.
There is just no other option. Let's be very clear with
that. So how much are we talking about?
In the tune of tens of thousands of rupees, and we've seen lakhs of rupees also being paid as ransom.
But for an individual?
For an individual, it's $300 you're talking about here, and that's 18,000 rupees. And the point is this, when you pay that, the worst part is you still don't know whether you'll get back the data or not. It's literally
there's no
like
guarantees.
There's no guarantee. There's no question of guarantees. So that's there. If you want to be scared a little more.
Yeah.
Now this is only to the point where the hacker takes the ransom for giving you back your data. If you protest, say, look, I'm not going to pay back the pay the money to you. There's an evolved form. There's something called doxware, which is doxing comes in, where the hacker will say, you know what, I'm not only going to delete your data, I will actually take that data and put it out in the public for everybody to see your emails, pictures, and guess what? I will tamper with that data. I will insert some fake chats, some fake pictures of yours, so that when somebody looks
and
at that...
And who's doing this?
So many people.
Okay.
So this is the full industry which is there. You can actually go to the deep web.
Well, that's scary enough. So what can you do? Just not open any links.
No, it's like asking.
Any attachments?
It's like asking if cars crashes, don't we go in the cars? You do that, but with the right brakes and controls in place. Out here, it's very stupid of people to not update a patch which came in 2 months back, officially released not only by Microsoft, but by CERT India and most of the nodal agencies across the globe.
Yeah.
Now, if you're not doing that, it's like, you know, if you're not wearing the seatbelt and you get crashed, there's a good chance you will die. And that's a bad thing, right?
Okay, so we've been scared enough. Saket Modi and Vandana Verma, thanks very much for educating us because so much of this just... We didn't know how it was going to play out, and now it's much, much clearer. But it is also quite scary, really. So make sure that your cyber security is up to date and you're safe. Your information is safe as well. That's it on Agenda. Thanks for watching. Thanks to all my guests. Goodbye.